Ready?
All right, guys. We got this, right?
I will follow.
deep in the night, you are coming again. With a shout from the sky, you are coming again. To take away your pride, to take away your pride. Here comes the King, all bow down. Lift up the voices unto the Lamb.
Love to the nations, bringing hope of the great. what does it mean to change the world? One person at a time. Each one of us is called to be a minister, to be a light, to be a beacon, someone who shows others the way to Christ. Amen? And so we are called to be His church, to be active, and to arise.
With each other, we have to admit that there are times in life whenever we have to make a choice about who we're going to hang around with. Because sometimes we encounter people that we would prefer to avoid. Maybe they challenge us. Maybe they are different than we are. Maybe they make us feel guilty. There are just some people in life who make us feel very, very uncomfortable, and we would prefer to avoid them at all costs. Now, we're nice people. We would behave in the way we're supposed to behave, but in our deepest places, there are just some people that we would prefer to avoid. Kind of like Gru in last year's hit movie Despicable Me, if you remember. It was a huge movie last year. It was a surprise hit. Lots of people went to see it, children, adults, everybody. And if you know, I just kind of set it up. Gru is a supervillain. I told the kids at VBS last week I was going to see some talk about Gru today, so whenever they came. But Gru is a supervillain who has this desire to steal the moon. And in his plot to do that, he needs some help from three little girls, Margot, Edith, and Agnes. Now, Gru has to adopt them, but he would prefer not to be with them at all, to avoid them at all costs. And yet he adopts them and he uses them to try to steal the moon because he's a supervillain and that's what he's going to do. But over time, something changes. These children that he would prefer to avoid at all costs, he falls in love with them and they become family. 2 weeks ago, Despicable Me 2 came up, and it is breaking all records at the box office. It is surprising everybody again by being the movie sensation of the summer and topping some of the others that were expected to be the blockbusters of the summer. And once again, Gru is struggling again with having to encounter or be around people that he would prefer to avoid.
Your work as a villain was kind of amazing.
In Despicable Me 2, Gru is confronted with one of life's ultimate challenges. I am talking about dating.
Hey there, Gru, Mr. Life of the Party. Well, I'm gonna go out on a limb. My friend Natalie is recently single.
No, get off the limb right now.
You see, for most guys, the lasting emotional scars of asking a girl out go way back.
Hey, Lisa, I was wondering if you...
Ew! Gru touched Lisa! Lisa's got Grudies!
Then the denial sets in.
So when you're going on your date?
What?
Are you scared?
Scared? Of what? Women? No, that's bonkers. I have no interest in going on a date. That's all. Case closed.
In Despicable Me 2, evil has a name.
Oh, I know someone whose husband just died.
I'm sorry, I did not see you there. Or there.
And it's Gru's neighbor, Jillian.
Gru! I have my friend Shannon here with me.
Tell Jillian I'm not here.
Gru's not here.
Are you sure?
Yes, he just told me.
Agnes, where's Gru?
He's putting on lipstick. He's swatting outside. He's pooping?
And Gru finds himself stuck on the worst blind date ever.
Wait a minute. Are you wearing a wig?
What?
You know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna rip that thing off your head and show everyone what a bald-headed phony you are.
I don't think so, Miss Lady. Hey, Gru.
Hello, Lucy.
Wow, looks like your date's been shot with a mild moose tranquilizer.
I would say any woman who carries and shoots moose tranquilizer darts is a keeper.
You love her, you love her, you really, really love her.
Okay, stop. This is a song of lies.
But asking someone that cool on a date, well, that can be intimidating.
Would you like to go out on a date?
No.
Okay, that's not helping. All right, here we go. For real this time.
If you see the movie, Gru wants to ask Lucy out on a date. She's another super villain if you're watching Despicable Me 2. But he doesn't want to make the telephone call, and he doesn't want to reach out to her. He's afraid that he'll be rejected whenever he does reach out to her. And it's all this conversation about people that we want to be with versus people we want to avoid in life. For the past couple of weeks, we've been talking about thinking big and believing big and acting big to achieve some kind of big results. And something we have come to realize very quickly is that if we're going to have big results and if we're going to join together and change the world, sometimes we're going to have to do some things we would rather not do. And sometimes we're going to have to hang around with people that we would rather not hang around with. Now, we're nice people. No one would ever know. But in our souls, let's be honest, we're called upon to change the world sometimes means doing things we don't want to do and being with people we would rather not be with. There's a story in the Bible. It actually wrestles with this of thinking big, acting big, believing big to get big results to change the world and forcing people to be around those they would rather not be around. The book in the Bible is the book of Esther. And if you read the book of Esther, fascinating book. It is a story from the beginning to end about a time in history. And this story talks about political intrigue, attempted political assassinations, genocide, espionage, makes what happens in Washington pale by comparison to what was going on in the book of Esther. And if you ever thought the Bible was boring, you've got to read the book of Esther. It will not be boring anymore. But the main character in the book of Esther, of course, is a woman by the name of Esther. Now, here's the stage, setting it up. There's a king in the world at that time by the name of King Xerxes. He has conquered most of the world, and he has a wife, the queen, and one day he calls the queen in to have her come before him and come into his presence in his court and wants her to talk and share and do some things, and she refuses. Well, you don't refuse the king. And so he exiles or banishes her, and he decides he needs to find another queen. And so he sets up, I guess for all intents and purposes, what we might call a beauty pageant, and he invites all the most beautiful women from around the conquered lands that he is now controlling to come for this beauty pageant. And in the midst of this, he's going to pick a new queen, and if you read the story, he finally picks Esther. Esther is from the country of Israel. The Bible calls them the children of God. She is a Jew, and yet she hides it because there are people in Xerxes' capital city who do not like the Jews and would like to either have them all removed from the capital city or, better yet, have them all killed. And so Esther hides the fact of who she really is because she knows there are people who will not want to hang around with her and will try to avoid her at all cost. And so in the midst of the story, as I said, there's all this political espionage and intrigue that's taking place. And then finally, some of Xerxes' advisors convince him that it would be best if all the Jews were killed, wiped out. And remember Esther? She's hiding who she is. Esther's family, particularly her uncle by the name of Mordecai, encourages her, pressures her, pushes her to do something big, to get some big results, to save her people. And there's a verse in Esther chapter 4, verse 14, that is sort of this pivotal verse in the book of Esther that if you read anything about this is always brought up. It's a sort of a catchphrase that has sort of gained prominence and people don't even know it's related to the book of Esther. But if you read verse 14, this is Mordecai giving Esther some advice. If you keep silent at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise for the people. God will save the people from some other quarter. Somebody else will be used for them to do what God wants done. But you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to this royal dignity for just such a time as this. Perhaps God has called you to this moment in time, in this place, Esther, so that you can think big, act big, believe big to get some big results for just such a time as this. And if you read the story, Esther, she does some things and handles situations in certain ways, and eventually the Jewish people are saved. Fascinating story. And Mordecai's word, her uncle's words, prove true, that God had placed her in this moment, in this place, at this time, to think big, act big, believe big, to get some big results for such a time as this. For the past few weeks, we've been talking about thinking, believing, acting big to get some big results, change the world. And we've come to realize very quickly that when you're changing the world, sometimes we have to do some things we'd rather not do and hang around with people we'd rather not hang around with. Last Saturday, about 140 of us gathered over at Trailer City off of Bird Neck and Virginia Beach Boulevard. It's a place where, for many of us, we had never gone before. In fact, most of us had never seen it before. And for a lot of us, we were wandering around trying to find it that morning. And then once we got there, we were divided up into five or six different work sites and given maps, and we had to wander around trying to find the large number of, well, trailer parks that are in Trailer City so that we might do the projects. And we were thinking big and acting big, believing big, getting big results, changing the world, and we were doing some things that we would rather not be doing on a day we'd rather not be doing them, surrounded by people that we would probably never talk to in the course of our normal life. And yet, in the midst of all of that, something began to happen. Lots of stories, lots of people talking about change the world too. Here's what one person said while she was working at one of the sites. I had many times that I prayed to God for strength to complete the job that I was given. The job was challenging for me, and there was lots of people coming, giving me advice and checking in on us periodically, but it was really just me and two teenage girls doing the work. The work was challenging for all of us. Several times I wanted to quit and give up because I would fix something there on the trailer, and then it would slip out and need to be repaired again. We learned perseverance that day. Through a lot of prayer and a lot of focus and a lot of determination, we finally completed the job. It was a definite God moment for me. We gathered at Trailer City to change the world. In a place where we're brutally most honest with ourselves, we'd rather not have been, surrounded by people that we tend to avoid. And then something happened. It looked like this.
Today I'm gonna try change the world. I'm gonna take it one day at a time. I made my resolution. I've opened up my eyes. Today I'm gonna try change the world. I'm gonna say hello to my neighbor. Gonna greet him with a smile and shake the hand of a stranger sitting tall here for a while. Gonna tell someone I love them from the bottom of my heart. I'm gonna try change the world. Yeah, today I'm gonna try and change the world. Gonna take it one day at a time. I made my resolution. Open up my eyes. Today I'm gonna try and change the world. I'm gonna make sure my children know right from wrong. Never turn my back on those who need someone. Always gonna try to see myself through another's eyes. Yeah, I'm gonna try change the world. Yeah. Yeah, today I'm gonna try and change the world. Gonna take it one day at a time. I've made my resolution. I've opened up my eyes. Today I'm gonna try and change.
Conversations with the city of Virginia Beach. This is how it works. Trailer City is in the no-fly zone, you know. And so as long as the trailers are habitable, people can live there. But as soon as one reaches a level of disrepair, becomes uninhabitable, is condemned, it's pulled out, and no trailer replaces it. So for the residents of Trailer City, there is nowhere else to go after this. And so we partnered with some of the officials from the city of Virginia Beach, and the goal was to try to help them to hang on just a little while longer. And so we were called to think big, to act big, believe big, to get some big results, to go to some place most of us would choose to avoid, to hang around with people that most of us would never hang around with. But when you do it with the love of Jesus Christ, something happens. Trailer City changes. But we change as well. We gather here in this place to share some stories. One of the teams came back, and it's fascinating who lives there. One of the teams came back from Worksite 2, and they were working on a trailer where the toilet was sinking and a rotted floor and the front door had rotted out and the roof was rotted. And the woman who lived there, she raised daylilies. And you go in her backyard and there's this rainbow of color from lilies that she had was bringing together with some hybrid techniques. She's creating her own stuff in the midst of that place of deep despair. People who were working there on that trailer kept wandering out in the garden to see creation, God's creation at work, to know that God was still in that place. When you're trying to change the world, sometimes we're called upon to go places we don't want to go, to do things we do not want to do, and to be with people we would just as soon avoid. But when you do it in the name of Jesus Christ, we realize something happens. Trailer City changes. So do we. We're different. Kind of like Gru in Despicable Me number one. The most pivotal moment in that movie from last year was after all of the movie, down towards the end when things are winding down, Gru comes into the girls' bedrooms and he realizes how much he loves them. He wanted to avoid them. He wanted at one time to even send them back to the orphanage. But he shares with them a book that he wrote himself, One Big Unicorn. And in that moment, the world changes.
Tonight, we are going to read a new book. This one is called One Big Unicorn. By who wrote this? Oh, me! I wrote it. Oh, look, it's a puppet book.
Here, watch this.
That's the horn.
This is gonna be the best book ever.
Not to pat myself on the back, but yes, it probably will be. Here we go.
One big unicorn, strong and free, thought he was happy as he could be. Then three little kittens came around and turned his whole life upside down.
Hey, that one looks like me.
No, what are you talking about? These are kittens. Any relation to a person's living or dead is completely coincidental. They made him laugh. Ha ha! They made him cry. Ooh.
He never should have said goodbye.
And now he knows he could never part from those three little kittens that changed his heart. The end. Okay, all right. Good night.
Sometimes we find in life that those people that we try to avoid, if we connect with them in the love of Jesus Christ, we fall in love with them. They become family, and they change our world. For the past few weeks, we have been talking about thinking big and believing big and acting big to get some kind of big results, results that might even change the world. Somebody sent me a quote this week and it says, having a rough day, place your hand on your heart. Place your hand on your heart. Feel that? It's your heartbeat. It's called purpose. You're alive for a reason. Courthouse Community United Methodist Church. Don't ever give up. You were created for such a time as this. You were placed in this place, at this time, in this moment, for such a time as this. To think big, believe big, act big, so that we might achieve big results through the love of Jesus Christ, and yes, change the world. We've been called in this place to do the sharing of God's love with everybody we meet. We've been called in this place to reach out a helping hand to those who are in need in this community and around the world. We've been called in this place to share the love we've experienced and the blessings we've experienced and the abundance of God's grace and mercy that we've experienced with the world. In Despicable Me, Gru, he wanted to avoid those kids at all costs. And yet, over time, as he invested himself in them, as he lived with them, as he interacted with them, as he shared meals with them, as he reached out to help them, he suddenly realized in that moment that he fell in love with them. And the world changed. People at Courthouse Community United Methodist Church, as followers of Jesus Christ, we are called to find something that we are willing to die for and to live for it every single day. Isn't that what Jesus did for us? Can we do anything less? Pray with me. God, we gather here in this place this morning, called by you to think big, believe big, act big, to get some big results as we partner with you to change this world. Give us strength. Give us courage. Give us faith, God, because you have called us to step out of our comfort zones and to interact with people and to do things and to be places that we would rather avoid. And yet something happens in that moment. In that moment, the world changes. The world changes for those we try to avoid, and the world changes for us. And we experience love. God, there's lots of conversation right now about change the world to B and to C and to D and doing some things over the next few weeks so that we can go back and help our friends, our family there who live in Trailer City. Because after Trailer City, there is nowhere else to go. And this is Virginia Beach. Shouldn't have people living like that. God, give us courage to be your people, to partner with you to change the world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand and let us sing. 1, 2, 3.